cuts come from and a little bit on how we market these. And I'm going to leave it to our food service people and our retail people to talk further about how they're marketing them. But I want to talk just generally about how we've done with time. This is the forward shoulder, the front shoulder, referred to as the chuck. A couple things you have to remember about a beef carcass, and particularly the chuck, okay? If you remember, towards the end of an animal and lower on the animal is tougher because the muscles are doing more work, moving more, muscles of locomotion. So that's certainly true of this end. Okay, in addition, you have to remember, and this is true of you too, that front leg is not connected to the body by bone. Okay, that arm bone connects into that scapula, or that blade bone, and that blade bone floats in muscle, and that's true of you too, right? Your arm is not actually connected by bone to your body. And so if you think about it, all these muscles have to hold the weight of the animal up in the front, which is where a lot of its weight is, especially the head and the neck. Okay, so you have to imagine that's going to make these muscles tougher. All right? Additionally, just generally speaking, biologically, four-legged animals will deposit fat from the front of the animal back. Okay? So there's going to be more fat between the muscles in the front of the animal as opposed to the back of the animal. You'll see that in chuck roasts that have lots of fat between the muscles as opposed to the round roasts that are a lot leaner between the muscles, what we call seam fat. Okay? Now, depending on which century it is or even which decade it is, we can talk about how we would market this. Okay? The old way of doing this was, remember those boneless closely turned retail cuts that give you that 45%? Cutters don't like to hear 45%. We want to sell you as much bone as we can. Okay, so if we can put as many bone-in cuts into the boxes as possible, that's great. And so that's what we did. We would take these things and literally start making chuck roasts, run them on the bandsaw and create these 1 to 2 pound roasts. They can either be cut this way, okay, for chuck roasts, or they can be cut off the arm, we call it arm roasts. Okay, and those were very common, very large roasts. The way we consume meat these days, and I can go off on another hour tangent on this, we don't tolerate that anymore. Okay. We're dual-income households. We don't have time to spend 2 or 3 hours on a pot roast. We simply don't tolerate the big cuts. We want smaller and more convenient, so that doesn't fit. Okay, so what we do is we start to disarticulate this, meaning we start pulling the muscles apart. There are a lot of muscles up here that pulled out separately can actually serve very well as steaks. Okay, and that's what a lot of the beef checkout dollars have done in their research, is evaluated every muscle in the carcass to see which ones can be marketed individually as steaks. Okay, to add value back to them. Because at the end of the day, if I can't sell this as roast and I can't sell this steaks, I've got to grind it up, make ground beef. And that's fine. We eat 60 to 70% of our beef is ground beef. So that's nothing to sneeze at. Problem is when I grind it, I have to charge less for it, which means I have to charge more for this. Okay, and this becomes a little bit unruly as far as the price is concerned. I'll get to that here in a minute. The most successful cut, if you talk about the value cuts, thus far, by far, has been the flat iron. Okay, the flat iron is the infraspinatus muscle. It's basically a muscle that lays right here on the top of the blade, top of that angel wing. Okay, and this isn't a technical workshop. We're not going to get into all the muscles separately and break them all out. But if you can imagine, if there's a big flat bone here and there's a muscle sitting on it, it doesn't do a lot of work because it's got bone all the way around it almost. It's anchored a lot by bone, so it does less work. In fact, that muscle is the second most tender muscle in the carcass, next to the tenderloin. Okay, so if we pull this out separately, we can market that as a flat iron. When we do that, we can no longer sell that roast, the old seven bone roast, because that muscle's gone. Okay, the trick with that is there's a piece of sinew that runs down the middle of it, so you actually have to take that muscle and fillet it like a fish. Okay, but once you do that, you're left with flat iron steaks. They're very marketable, very good product. We also have things like the mock tender, the beef tender medallions, things of that nature. Other things we're doing, something you have to remember, that just because arbitrarily we as man have taken our knife and we've cut right here and said, okay, that's a chuck and that's a rib, great. Okay, but that's not how the muscles work. Those muscles continue on. So if you can imagine, this guy right here on this side, this would be considered a ribeye. Okay, but up here, it's considered a chuck eye. Okay, also marketed as a Delmonico steak. Okay, $11 a pound, $7 a pound. Okay, so if you got up to about here, you can still market chuck eyes. Okay, and you can do this as chuck eye roast or chuck eye steaks. Okay, and then from there you can actually get a roll. And this is the chuck roll, okay, which we can also market essentially as the America's roast. Okay, and there's a number of other cuts. We're not going to pull them all apart. But that's our challenge in something like the chuck. And we have to find a value to increase the value of this so that we can drive the price of this down. Again, at the end of the day, if I cannot market it, it's got to go through the grinder. And that's a problem.